Hello and welcome to the Overton Audios podcast. My name's Connor Chadwick.
And I'm Daniel Patton.
And on today's podcast, I'll be talking with Matthew Tyrrell and Thomas Aiden James about the Alacrity Doctor New Year special. And then we'll be looking back to a previous podcast segment 3 years ago when me and Dan talked about the short trip, the Cravat Doctor short trip, in fact, called King of Rock.
Remember like yesterday?
Yes, well, I kind of don't. But nonetheless, how have you been, Daniel? Because this is obviously the new, this is obviously 2024 when this comes out, but we're recording it even before Christmas.
Well, yes, it is a week before Christmas Eve, in fact, and I don't know how Christmas is going to go. I mean, this is the first year in a very, very long time that we're having a full family Christmas, because last year family went off abroad, and years prior we had COVID. So this is the first proper family gathering in some time.
Oh, wow. Well, I hope it goes well. It's the first Christmas that I'm not with... Well, this is going to sound odd. Well, I'm not with my blood family. Because on Christmas Day, I'm going to be seeing my partner.
Yes, yes. We talked about this really out of the podcast. And are you excited for that, my dear sir?
It'll be interesting. I was very nervous about it initially, because obviously my dad was asking, are you coming over, or are you going to be, what are you going to be doing? And it's the first year that this is happening, so it's just one of those interesting ones where things start to change, and it's like, you know.
Going through what I think I went through last year. I mean, last year was the first year I didn't have Christmas with my blood family, with my side of the family, because again they went away that Christmas. So it was the first Christmas I spent with the in-laws.
Oh yes.
So I think your experience of what I experienced last year, you're sort of going in, you're dipping your toes into unfamiliar territory in a season that should feel like familiar. You know what I mean? Don't say you won't feel uncomfortable. It's just saying it's a new experience of kind of Christmas for you.
Well, I also feel kind of bad as well, because a lot of my family are also going abroad as well this year. But only my dad and stepmom are staying in England. So they're going to be just them two on Christmas now.
Oh, so,
and I was that's what I was so conflicted about, because I was like, okay, what am I like? I can't not like what, and then we've decided that we found a way to make it work, but I just like, there's still part of me that doesn't feel like it's quite right. But hey ho, when this comes out, Christmas will have happened anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, so the last couple of podcasts have been very, very interesting, because they've not been our usual podcasts.
No, they haven't.
We had an October podcast, which was, I mean, to tell you honestly, we haven't really had a normal podcast since the one that you came back in.
It has been a bit sporadic.
Yeah, because we had that where we talked about, you know, the announcement of the Alacrity Doctor and the Young Doctor starting. And then the next one, we had a eulogy in it.
Yeah.
Which was obviously for the late Harry Gosling. And then the one after that was a 4-hour podcast about everyone's 60th anniversary specials.
It was hard to fit like loads of regular segments in at that point as well. I mean, I wasn't even like, podcast hosted there for that one.
And then, of course, we had the Christmas one, which was a lot more casual. It was something where we just kind of hung out a bit. So we've missed out on months of comments reading. We've missed out on so much. So I think we better start catching up then, sir. I think should we go to the first segment where I talked to Matthew Tyrrell and Thomas Aiden James about the Alacrity Doctor New Year special?
Yes, wrong holiday, but right special. Let's cut to that.
Overton Audios presents...
I'm the Doctor. I can help.
Oh, well, that's helpful, that is.
It's time to take action. Sentry guards, locate the Doctor. Bring him to us.
My box. It's gone.
And you're asking for help?
Yes, please.
Listen, mate.
Doctor.
Whatever. We've just been to a house party, like...
Fire!
What's causing that?
Get back.
Identity confirmed.
Oh.
It will help us in a war.
A war?
In your future. Once in the mainframe, the computer automatically downloads the information in your mind to join with the collective. Time Lords are a vile and disgusting race who need to be reminded of their place in this universe.
That's not right. Sure, like any species, some lose their way.
We have it on record that a Time Lord is directly involved with the war.
Which Time Lord?
Doctor Who, the Alacrity Doctor Adventures. Infinite Exordium. Coming the 1st of January 2024 at 12 p.m.
A teleport, yes.
What? Like Star Trek?
Star Trek?
Yes, a bit like that.
Hello and welcome back to the podcast, and I am here with Matt Tyrrell and Thomas Aiden James. Hello everyone.
Hello Connor, how are you?
Hello, I'm Connor. Good, thanks. How are you both doing?
Oh, I'm doing all right. It's good to be back here after my last trip into the adventures of Overton Audios podcast.
I believe that was in September, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, because that was after the Minisode had come out. Oh, yeah. Like the big announcement. And Thomas, how are you?
Oh, I'm fine, yeah. Just a bit cold, obviously. It's... I think we're recording this, it's during the colder seasons. So, yeah. I'm still feeling a bit of the cold, really. I'm hoping that it will warm up soon. But obviously, knowing end of the year, when we're recording this, obviously, is coming soon, it's not going to warm up.
No. So before we get into talking about the Alacrity New Year special, I wanted to quickly bring up with Thomas the fact it's been 3 years since he's been on the podcast.
Yes, it has. Yes, I believe I was in the Resurrection Series 4 section when we were talking about...
Yes, I believe
Man
so.
...Man in the Street, yes. Since then, there's been a lot more that's been released since then, I think.
The whole landscape of Overton Audios has very much changed,
yes,
a couple of times.
Yeah, absolutely.
This is the perfect time to say he's back. Last minute returns.
I think both Crimson Hunters have come out. I remember that.
Oh wow! Yeah.
Yeah, and then my last performance sort of audio.
Yes,
made,
in the middle of 2021, there was what was it? It was
Tortured Retrospective.
Tortured, yes, where you reprised the role as Father Shaw.
Yes.
Wasn't that also 3 years?
No, it was about a year actually, because
General Marsh.
Yeah, I recorded General Marsh 1 and 2 sort of late 2019.
Yes, of course.
And then I recorded the Tortured thing in late 2020. And ever since then I've not done much except for a couple of things lately, but let's not say about that.
Well, I'm just looking.
We can't say about one of them, because one of them will have been released by this point, and that's Wonders of the Fourth Dimension 1.
Oh, that's true. That's true. Yes, you did a couple of last minute roles for that. So, and thank you very much again.
Oh, you're very welcome.
But yeah, the last time you appeared in the podcast was the 4th of August 2020.
Oh my goodness.
So that's been about nearly three and a half years.
Wow.
but ultimately, and this leads into the overall story, 8 months before that, being New Year 2020, that's when, isn't that, correct me if I'm mistaken, when the original Infinite Exordium was made?
It was May 2020 it came out, the original original.
Yeah, oh, okay, so not when, so when I recorded with Thomas, it hadn't been that long after.
No.
It really hadn't, actually. I could find out the exact date for you.
Can do. But the original Infinite Exordium, which is, for those listening and may not be aware what the title of the Alacrity New Year special is, that came out, I think, a couple of days ago, as of when this comes out. As of us recording it now, it's just been recorded, so we'll hopefully it'll be out on time. But... No, like, so that it was originally made as part of pilot kind of special episode to kick off a different sort of fan series that you were both working on, which also starred Matt playing the Doctor. That got made, didn't it? I think I've seen a version of it somewhere.
It did, yeah. Because yeah. Sorry, Matt.
Okay. Oh, bloody hell. I've said in the other podcast, there have been many different attempts of doing fan stuff. Like we had 2017 and 18 where I decided to make awful fan films, for lack of a better term. But in 2019, I sort of started fiddling with making a new audio series. I did like a sort of preview for, that was like 3 or 4 minutes at the end of 2019. And that obviously became what happened in Infinite Exordium with a few changes in there for the full episode, which came out on May 15th, 2020.
Oh, yes.
The goal of that originally was just to sort of like get something on the ground with this new sort of like Doctor. The Doctor is a completely different Doctor, bloody hell. Like, yeah. Compared to Alacrity, yeah, it's not night and day, but like it's like I'm playing it much differently this time. Mm-hmm. Like with compared to Alacrity, like this this Doctor wasn't as energetic and a bit more like and when it comes to Alacrity, like he's a lot more. I've tried to take a more energetic approach to this Doctor, as you probably would have heard in the episode, if I'm honest.
Yeah.
So the old one, yeah, it was sort of a pilot. It was just sort of like, yeah, get something on the ground, introduce characters, sort of set up a story arc. Like it was going to be like the very like start of it, and just have something to like get to move into new stories, because the original wasn't actually a post-generation story. It was just like just picking up at a random point, because I from all the attempts at fan films, I've just came to the conclusion I can't do post-generation stories. Like I kept making the same one, and it just ended up just being a bit of a rip-off of other fan films and audios. So I was like, okay, no more post-generation stories. Let's make something just completely new that is not a patron generation. Just kick off at a random point and be like, hello, I'm the Doctor. Let's get going. Let's just try to tell something new here.
Yeah. So ultimately, because with regards to this particular episode, though, I would class it as post-regeneration, but it's kind of half and half, because we had and obviously by this point, we can kind of talk about this. We can. This will be coming out in January. the Prism 60th, which was truly an introduction into the aftermath of what it was like playing or being the blonde Doctor, who ended up going through a very tough period of his life towards the end of it, and Alacrity, who I remember you saying in the very early days, Matt, you wanted to really kind of have a very positive outlook on things and not be too dark. You wanted it to you wanted some life and light to be brought back to the Doctor in a way.
Yeah, it's because I felt like there was too many like dark nitty gritty and like not negative, but like yeah, I sensed an imbalance, and I looked at the Prism timeline and was like, we should probably try tip the balance back towards a more positive outlook.
Fair play, and but as a result, we explored in the Prism 60th, and I felt like it was a really good opportunity to do that within the context of a 60th anniversary special, which was for a newly regenerated Doctor to get to meet other incarnations of themselves whilst they're trying to discover their own identity. So with Alacrity having been born as this completely new man who his future, they don't even recognize him as a Doctor in the first place. They don't remember ever being him. So that causes existential crisis anyway. But then simultaneously, you've got the past who are just like, oh, okay, you're the Doctor, cool. And it's stuff that he remembers. He remembers being the Northern Doctor, remembers being the young Doctor and the blonde, but they are his past, and it's currently the past of his previous incarnation that is dragging him down, and he's trying to find his way out to the light. Ultimately, by the end of the story, there's this really nice scene between blonde and Alacrity where Alacrity is very much like I was just you about maybe half an hour to an hour ago. And
yeah, that's something I wanted. I think me and George talked about because I remember like the idea. I think it was that Paddington Station. We just randomly met up in London when I was heading back up to uni. I was like, that would be a good scene, and I think that's where it sort of came from.
Yeah, you both kind of turned to me and said, "Can we make sure there's a scene in there?" Because it's one of those things where it's a bit difficult with, well, not difficult, but you feel bad for the blonde doctor because he's constantly being told that he is worth being the doctor and having the title of it, but his self-doubt overrides him a lot of the time. And with regards to this Alacrity, we wanted to be sure that he knew who he was at the end of the story and that he was comfortable. He wasn't carrying over any of those insecurities into his next and new life. Which I think in this New Year's special, we really kind of show. Like, it starts off with him running away from Vikings that are trying to murder him, and he's having a right laugh while doing it.
I think it was Romans in the original one, so we just started to switch up.
Yeah, it was Romans, I remember, yeah.
It's just, literally, I only made it Vikings because Aiden can do an amazing Viking impression.
Yeah, he's good.
Yeah,
he's good.
Yeah, he did one for the Queer Doctor Adventures on TT Productions. He played a Viking about a year ago for them now. So I knew he could do it. I've naturally had a bit of creative burnout. So we've written this with, I think we wrote this with about a month and three quarters to spare.
I was probably leaning over your shoulders like, red alert, we need to get this done.
Yeah, you were kind of over my shoulder for about 2 months. And I was just like, yes, but I need to write the first Doctor first. And then I need to edit that. And then I need to do this. And I need to do that. And you were very, very patient with me. But we got it done.
I think that's something we got. And I think the end result was worth it because, I think you saw how happy I was when we got it done. And I was just like, oh my God, this is something that's actually good now. I can actually look at it and be like, oh wow, it's good.
I'm very much a fan of going back over old fan film concepts and enhancing them. I do that with my own enough. Like with the current Cravat Doctor companions, Patrick and Professor Traddy, they were the first companions I ever made in fan films ever.
Mm.
They're like a 2007, 2008 creation for me when I was like 12. But that's the thing, I like taking what you knew when you made it once before and enhancing it, because then it just, you feel so much better for feeling like you finally did it right. Carry on.
And just to add to that point, Connor, that's another reason why I wanted to do this, because when I released it back then, I was so proud of it. Like, I was like, and Thomas, you probably remember how buzzing I was.
Honestly, it was like, it's like when you've released your first thing and you've had nothing else, but you just want to get that first thing out. And it's like, wow, I know where to start and I know where to begin and I know where to continue. And, you know, you really were like that. And I remember sort of like talking to you and saying like, you know, maybe we can get this plan sorted soon enough.
Yeah,
and I think it's also like by then it was nearly 3 years of trying to make a sort of fan film, fan audio. I finally stuck the landing, and it got a good reception when I just checked the comments back on it, and it had good reception, and I was like,
I definitely liked it.
Take the strengths of that and take it into this new one and enhance it. It's like you said, Connor, it's more satisfying and rewarding.
Yeah, exactly. And it's like, for example, I suppose, because the New Year special very much, it's a story of introducing Alacrity and the new companion Lorna to one another. I think originally, because there have been a lot of things in the planning for the first volume that we were sorting out, like originally the companion wasn't even going to be introduced in the New Year special, and then it was, and then it was going back and forth, a lot of ideas back and forth. But honestly, with regards to what we planned, with regards to the fact that this New Year special acts as an introduction to this Doctor, an introduction to the characters, this era, and also then shows what's coming up for the future, like obviously the Seeker got away at the end of the story. We haven't actually.
He's off somewhere.
We haven't actually decided what we're doing at that yet, but I do have some ideas. And
we have a rough idea, I think.
And Centurion with his sentry guards were there as well. They obviously got kind of defeated at the end of that story. But there's opportunities because they're from the future and already know of the Doctor. There's opportunities there for them to maybe make a reappearance. Who knows? Yeah. But it very much sets up what's coming up for the first volume, which I don't know if we've got a rough plan. In the upcoming, well, I say this is how far in advance we've recorded this for those listening. In the December Overton Audios podcast, which is not out for another 2 weeks, me and Dan have already run through the upcoming releases for 2024. Mm-hmm. And we've marked this down for, at the very latest, this coming out in the summer.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it, with the way things are currently going with regards to production, I think the summer is probably the latest we'll have it out by. But I, not to say for that sure. We can't have it.
Yeah.
We're not, like, I don't want this coming out in autumn. It needs to, it would be absolutely too long. So that's why I've told people in the podcast, of course, that
I'm giving everyone
the latest dates possible.
Multiple episodes have already started being written.
So. Yes. Well, to be honest, you were already writing them, and I hadn't even written the New Year special.
Yeah, I started. I started that in April.
That's the thing, because it makes sense. It's one of those things where this first Alacrity volume has been in the works for a long time, because what people don't realize, and sometimes maybe I forget, is that 60th Cardiff minisode we shot was shot back in January. It's been 11. It's nearly been 11. Well, I think it has been nearly. Yeah, it's been nearly 11 months as recording this. By the time this comes out, it will have been a year.
Oh God!
So, like that's what I'm meaning, is that there's a lot of planning that's gone into this. The New Year special may have only been written really about a month ago, but the planning has been there the whole time for this volume. To try and get it right, get everything set up properly so that we can continue to make a multi-volume storyline, which is the intention.
Yeah.
And we're doing it up there.
Oh.
Yeah.
I was going to say it's something because I joined the volume a bit late. I was actually probably the last writer to be assigned.
This whole thing was kept secret from you.
Yeah.
you didn't find out until about 2 months ago when the minisodes came out.
Yeah.
Bad out of everyone else.
Even though I remember George, and there's a picture of George and Matt somewhere where they both have the same costume. All I thought that was, they're cosplaying together. That's nice. I did not notice for any second that they were like... When you released the monthly vlog for the Cardiff stuff, I actually thought it was for TT, and knowing that Matt was announced as the companion for TT, I actually thought it was like a live action sort of TT role, because I saw a Dickensian there and I thought, oh, right, okay, the Dickensian and Matt's going to be involved. Right, okay, so we're going to do...
I told you, Matt. I told Matt at the time, Dickensian's a good cover.
Yeah. And it really was a, honestly, I've
Matt,
kind of been
Matt was all on high security for this. He was like, no, you don't understand. Thomas is like a detective.
I know him. If we need to, I was like deliberately hidden from vlogs.
It was like when we cut you out of the January vlog completely, Matt. Like and just because we weren't sure, like, oh, we can't, you know, no, we can't see that, no.
Yeah.
And then but then it was when the Divergent stories started to come out, and then Thomas went, Matt's in a lot of these. And we were like, oh, oh.
to be honest, you were playing the Zeta President, so, and that was a role that you played in about January. So I was kind of thinking, right, that's falling on from there. But then I think when you were in another one as well, I was just thinking, there's a catch to this, isn't there? Matt's going to be sort of the. I thought actually, even though I knew James Sutton was the warden in that, I actually thought Matt was like another warden. I thought he was like another recurring sort of cast member in all of them, but unfortunately,
I just remember the crazy times of like trying to throw you off with other things and just like, say, just, oh,
I do remember.
There were some near misses. I was like,
Yeah, I do remember you told me about Cardiff, and I was like, right, you've been to Cardiff, right? Okay. Obviously, I think you did mention a meetup, and I thought, oh, okay, right, I'll just say it's a meetup and that, as usual. But no, it's just yeah,
We tried to sort of
absolutely.
play it off like,
I made up a random reason for him.
yeah, we tried to come up
What
with
was that
like,
random reason? I can't remember now.
I think it's just because I was invited because I lived in Wales.
Yes, yeah, I think it was, yeah.
Even though I was the first person to leave for Cardiff, and I only got there 10 minutes before everyone else.
Yeah,
Thanks, infrastructure.
yeah, it was one of those things where even Matt was like, should I be cast in this much? And I'm like, look, we met up in January. Like, it's gonna look like from an outside perspective that we met up and I just cast you in a couple of things because I knew you a lot better. That's all it's gonna look like.
It's
We were
the other thought of not realizing how long they would take to get out.
either meant to come
Because I think the
out.
original
Those were
plan,
meant to
yeah,
come out in March. Matt,
yeah. So that
sometime
he was me
March, April, May.
thinking, March, like they'd be out in March or May. So I was sitting there hoping, it's like, oh, I won't be long till they're out now. I can tell Thomas we can get actually start planning things out because, like, because Thomas has done is obviously he's a very close friend of mine, and I've known him for like, God, what's it, nearly 6, 5 years.
About 6.5 years, yep.
And we obviously worked on the original sort of run,
Yeah.
and we was going to like sort of make stuff
Right,
that
Matt,
coincided with each
do you
other.
remember? And I hope you're going to find out, your comment might find out something about this. There was
Oh.
actually a revival before this revival, and I actually wrote a story for you in that revival of it.
There was an
Because,
attempt.
yeah, there was an attempt, because I have somewhere like a path written script of like a Sherlock mystery episode, which I pitched to Matt, and that's I sort of half wrote it with the original companion in mind. And I'm just thinking if you remember that, yeah, because
I do remember it. It's just a matter of like I wish it got off the ground, to be fair. It's but like the funny thing is, I think we was I think that was I was sort of having that in my mind. I wanted to continue it, but like what was it, like a few days later, Connor cast me as Alacrity, so I was like, uh-oh.
So it's like, oh, oops.
Wasn't it like
Now
October?
what?
It was October, wasn't it, last
Yeah,
year?
very early October last year. Bloody hell, that feels like 1,000 years ago, and just like 10 minutes ago.
It's a mad thing, because I also think to myself how long it takes to sometimes get projects off the ground like this. It's been 13 months. You got cast, and then within 2 months we'd filmed the minisode, and then it was just the minisode that held us up, and then me holding us up with the New Year special, and then it was just a million and one things that was going on. But
Well,
I'm
see,
I
the year
feel
of the 60th, we sort of knew it was going to be a busy year.
God, I'm so tired.
Oh, aren't we
This
all?
year has just been so tiring, and I'm looking forward to, like, as of recording now, we've just got the Blonde Doctor Christmas special finalized and ready to go out, and that's been written for about a year.
Oof.
But just the sheer amount of just the sheer amount of things that have been going on this year have just meant I haven't been able to look at it properly, and it's as a result, it didn't really get recorded until quite late, and it's just been
As of
really
record,
rough.
as of recording, I recorded for it on an evening of Doc of the 20 of 23rd on Doctor Who Day, so it sort of felt kind of fitting. Like 3 days ago, as of recording this. That's how like it was like it's probably is the most one of the most last minute things on Overton Audios in terms
One
of
of them,
getting it done.
I think the last minute thing was the Comic Relief Nidrak special. We gave ourselves a week.
No,
Bloody hell.
I think I know something that more last minute.
Oh.
The Famasi Christmas tale that
Yeah,
was
that,
done in 2 days.
oh God, yeah, that was two
That was done in
days.
2 days.
Oh
Yeah.
God. Oh, that's
But
just classic
that
stuff.
was kind of fun because it was an audio book. So Sutton just recorded and I just kind of sat through it and just cut out any of the outtakes. Meanwhile, while literally whilst it was being recorded by Sutton, it was himself. Sutton, no, Sutton later made a couple later when he wasn't recording, but there was Isaac Blake, otherwise known as Motion Idea Films, and George was making a couple as well. Like, we had about three people making cover arts at the same time. Isaac made the overall fireplace one, And then all the other bits of what's going on in the story were made like as a mixture of George and Sutton and a bit of Isaac as well, depending on the detail. Mm-hmm. We are hoping to make one for this Christmas. But it's going up in scale and I'm tired. I'm so tired. And I don't know. And I feel like it needs to come out really within the next 2 weeks rather than on Christmas Day, like he suggested. Because on Christmas Day is another thing. But overall, I'm really, really chuffed with how we've come along with Alacrity. Dan recently finalized the Alacrity Doctor logo for the...
And when I saw it, I fell in love. I was like, I think it would be.
It's been really nice as well, because it's not often that this happens, that we get to have little production Zooms or little Zoom call chat things. And we talk about, I remember you were on call with Dan and you told him the rough idea for the logo. He's drawn it. You've gone, yeah, something like that. My drawings are, and then you tried to draw it and we're like, no, this is really awful. And then he's gone ahead and made this. And you're like, oh my God, you saw my vision. Like,
he's a mastero.
Yeah. But like, that's the thing, is that he's then come together and it's like, it reminds me, it's why I loved Doctor Who Confidential so much. And I still haven't watched the Doctor Who Unleashed for the Starbase.
Oh.
As of recording, obviously. Mm-hmm. But I loved watching like the little previews they've got on social media where they showed the concept art for the Star Beast and then you see the actual episode.
Yeah.
For me, it's like the concept art was your drawing, Matt.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And then look at what's been made now. It's so nice seeing that process and the evolution of it all, you know? But yes, is there anything else that either one of you wanted to add about this New Year special or about Alacrity generally?
I would like to say... I haven't heard everything because like it's just been recorded.
Yeah.
But I've heard bloody hell. I've heard Kath's, who's my companion, Lorna. She's absolutely amazing in it, and I think it was really good to have her in there. She's also one of my bestest friends as well. Mm-hmm. And I think it sort of like works because the way I sat and I sort of imagine Alacrity and Lorna is just me and Kath. At this point, and to have you, Connor, and you, Thomas, you're both extremely close friends as well. To have you all on the line producing this is, with me, it's like I couldn't be happier with how things are going. And I only really hope that we can actually make something of a story that we're all very proud of. And yeah. Gives something to the audience that makes them feel a bit something. It's like I said in the other podcast, make a story that's sort of hopeful and is able to like give us some sort of good thing, make the audience feel good.
Yeah.
And I think this episode has accomplished that, and I'm very excited to hear the full thing.
Indeed. And Thomas, do you have anything you wish to add?
Just honestly, a thank you for just... let me sort of produce it. Honestly, it's kind of been the first sort of proper team kind of production I've been on. I've produced stuff by myself and that, and it's a harder job when you're producing by yourself, especially when like people you know just aren't there anymore and that, especially when it comes to like just producing it in a team like this. I've just got to thank you very much, Matt and Connor, honestly, for giving me the sort of allowance to kind of help with anything that needs to be helped with, honestly, because with the New Year special, honestly, there was a couple of things that you could have changed in that, but I believe like we've all come together and kept a couple of things that even the original had, and I think still worked in this new version.
I agree, and of course, like, thank you to you both as well. I know that there's a lot of thanks being thrown my way, but honestly, I am, even though I'm cutting down on like release schedules and stuff like that, it still feels like I've got a million and one things to do, but they're just not got a release date on them which I suppose is a bit.
There's less pressure.
Yeah,
it felt very uneasy for me at first, going, I don't know what's a priority and what isn't anymore, because there's no dates telling me what's a priority anymore. But no, it's been really nice to sort of work on stuff, and I can kind of look at things now a bit more leisurely without thinking, you know, like the whole thing, the reason why this New Year special took a little while to get written was because I was sticking to those schedules and I was falling behind on the schedule too. So and of course, I think I've already alluded to this, but before we say farewell to this segment, obviously, Thomas, you played Father Shaw in the past.
Yes.
And I think at this point, without saying as well, we mentioned Torchwood earlier, we are going to be remaking the Knife Trilogy, where there are, I've already spoken to you about this, Thomas, like maybe about a year ago, I don't know. But
I believe so, yeah. I think there's rumblings of, like, I definitely remember there was a message saying, like, oh, more Father Shaw stuff is being planned. I'm like, oh, thank you very much. Because I absolutely love the character, and it's honestly been wild to think that, like, there's been a lot more sort of master related stuff and not really sort of show related stuff, but I'm glad that that's getting planned out as well, because I really like the original sort of retrospective, but I do feel like somehow we can also make it a bit better as well.
Yeah, like not casting cancelled people.
Oh dear. Yeah.
Well,
we won't go into that any further. But
yeah. Well, I was more thinking of just my own performance, really, because back then I sort of had a slight little deviation from, like, beforehand, because when I bulk recorded all the stuff beforehand as the character, I sort of had that one sort of type of character I wanted to do. But when it came to retrospective, because I thought this is after a lot of the stuff, because I think the previous stuff I'd done beforehand was General Marsh, so it was a lot more of a kind of a new character in a way, and it's going back to sort of a bit of the origins of it. But with retrospective, it was more like we're going towards the future in that, and it's like, how do we pick up on this character when his present was 2 years ago and that?
But that's what we're intending to do with the Knife Trilogy. Obviously, with that was a trilogy of specials. But we're hoping now to kind of reimagine it into, rather than it being one special that represents one time period, we're going to make it a volume instead and really expand on it, which means that that will naturally be expanded upon for the Father Shaw story. Naturally, of course, we've done a recast on Matt Vowles recently. So that was where I thought the opportunity was there, because I was a bit in limbo with the Knife Trilogy for a bit as to what was and wasn't canon, because of the, especially because it was made pre-DW 2012 split.
Yes.
And when it goes through the present day side of Torchwood, it reflects and leans on a lot of the DW 2012 events.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So I really wanted to kind of reimagine that, and also it gives us the opportunity to tie in more things to the overall story of Torchwood that James Sutton is working on, which would be good.
Yeah.
But yes, nonetheless, thank you both of you for being available to chat.
And, my pleasure, still mine, Connor. Good to always have to be on the podcast.
Indeed. Absolutely. And then
we'll hand you back to future Connor and Daniel.
Indeed.
I hope the future is as well.
Yes, I hope Christmas and New Year served us well.
Yes.
We will find out.
Yeah.
And welcome back to the podcast. What an interesting segment that was, wasn't it, sweet Daniel?
Indeed, if I heard it.
indeed. So, we've got a lot of comments reading to do. We're going to do basically all of the 60th content, that being Torchwood 2000, the Prism 60th anniversary. And then we'll be talking with we'll be doing the comments reading for the First Doctor adventures. Yes, and the Divergent story. Thank you, Daniel. See, Daniel, no, you assist me. So, Daniel, would you like to take it away, Daniel, with the Torchwood 2000 comments reading?
No worries. So we're going to talk about the Weeping Room Part 1, and we have two comments here. One from Jan the Blue. I believe so. That's how you spell it. If not, I'm very sorry. This truly felt like watching a real episode of Torchwood. Gritty, dramatic, and great pacing. Bravo, wonderful. And from Michael Cox, the First Doctor himself, Torchwood 2000 meets a weeping angel. But of course, this is a perfect fit. A superb drama. Can't wait for part two. Shall we segue to part two?
Oh my goodness.
Yes, we're speeding through these circles. We have so many to do. For Michael Cox, yet again, the story really made great use of the Weeping Angel. Excellent performances from the cast. I really like the chemistry between Jax and Angel. I hope there will be opportunities to hear more of their relationship. That ending, though, wow, completely unexpected. I wonder whether there is any way for the character to reappear for other cameos. Mm.
Ooh.
I think it's Ewan the Bluey.
Yeah.
Joke was on the gang for expecting this angel to just go along with their orders when it had been used for very greedy purpose. Too bad it was a lesson learned too little, too late.
Oh my word. And then we move on to the comments reading for the Prism 60th. This is where it gets a little bit heavy. So... we have a comment here from MMS, otherwise known as Thomas Aiden James, saying, "The Prism 60th begins, and let me tell you, I had a blast listening to this one with my friends. We listened through and a great time with every moment involved, even if it did take twice as much time because we were having so much fun with it. Hopefully the rest of the Prism 60th can provide not only me, but other people with the same amount of entertainment and amazing quality as this part had. 10 out of 10. Michael Cox said, "With such a large cast, it could have been a challenge to keep all the various strands of the story distinct, but it has been achieved with great skill. This is a deliberately slow build, which gathers momentum, and as slowly but surely, multiple versions of the Doctor and their various companions, collaborators, and rivals assemble. An excellent beginning to the anniversary specials. Thank you for involving me." Then we have a comment here from Torchwood 0326-SO5BQ. Interesting username, who says, "Great job. I find it very exciting to hear all of these Doctors and companions together." Then we have a comment from Yarn the Blue saying, "A stellar cast and an amazing start to the Prism 60th anniversary story. Very timey-wimey, but then again, this is Doctor Who, so par for the course." And then we had someone called A.M. Young saying, "The ending, very interesting. I wonder what's going to happen next." We then also had a comment from someone saying, "As someone new to Overton Audios, can I please get a rundown of what to listen to and in what order?" I did respond to this. I just said it's probably better to go for story arcs, really, because I make some story arc playlists if they're looking for particular things there. But you can really start anywhere, really. That's what we kind of try and aim for. But thank you so much to everyone for comments on part one. We go on to part two with a comment from the same people, Torchwood 0326-SO5BQ, and they say, "Great job. I find it very exciting to see all of the Doctors and the companions together." That's a comment that was on part one. Okay. And then Michael Cox saying, "An action-packed adventure leading to a big reveal. Excellent." And then we have a comment from Multivoice Entertainment 7013 saying, "Well done, guys. Very well done. I was surprised that you bought this character back. I dread to know what's going to happen next." Now, obviously, we're not going to talk about who the villain is until really part three, but I just thought, you know, a little bit of mystery. And then we have a comment from MMS who says, "Glad to say I finished the second part with my good friend again, and we had another great time. Same laughs, same entertainment. I really like this one, but I'm not sure if I prefer it to last week's offering, but give it time. And the release of the third part, then we'll see what could be true. Otherwise, great work, especially made for some great popcorn entertainment with a friend. 9 out of 10. Thank you again so much to everyone who's commented there. And of course, on part one, I really appreciate it. We go on to part three, which starts with MMS saying, "This was honestly one of the best Overton audios I've ever listened to. Everything felt right and for the celebration of 60 years of the show, and it was needed. Every Doctor involved had something to do, and we all had some great moments with the companions, but in the end, it doesn't matter how much you put in. If it wasn't for the quality brought on by everyone involved, I wouldn't still be a major fan that I am of Overton audios to this day. Thank you, Connor, and thank you everyone involved. 10 out of 10, best anniversary ever. P.S. spoilers, I cried at the ending. It was so pitch perfect, and I'm so glad it was there because it's one of the best scenes in the special, and my friend that I listened to it to will tell you what I said. Very, very true. I can't remember what your friend said. I don't know, or if they did. They made a comment from Michael Cox saying, Prism's 60th anniversary special was a wonderful blending of classic Who, a sensitive nod to its former relationship with DW 2012, and all that has been carefully and lovingly built over the many years of Overton Audios. Prism now sits on a refreshed and very firm foundation with some new doctors who will have some interesting stories to tell. As noted previously by Thomas, every doctor involved had something to do, and there were some great moments with the companions. This is always a challenge for writers of multi-doctor stories, but Connor and Daniel rose to the task superbly. The story made an excellent use of the artifact and its array of characters, and was a great mix of action and reflective moments, resulting in a great celebration of Doctor Who. Naturally, I'm tremendously grateful to have been involved in the production itself, but as a listener, I also want to stress and express my thanks for an exciting and entertaining trilogy, which is a worthy contribution to the fandom's world-building of the Whoniverse. Happy anniversary to all members of the Prism Universe. You are valued and appreciated.
Here's Michael.
I mean, my God, that was a... What a comment.
Yeah. That's true. That basically...
There's no higher compliment than that, really, is there?
Really is not. Michael.
It makes all the stress worth it. And then last comment we had from Torchwood 0326-SO5BQ, who said, good work. I think it's very amazing. And thank you again. Again, thank you so much to everyone who commented and enjoyed the Prism 60th. Dan came up with the initial concept 3 years ago, where the main villain, I think, was actually meant to be Rassilon. And then with the split, the universe split that we had to do with DW 2012, it gave us options to explore that and also add... spoilers, Omega into it.
Yep.
it gave us so many more opportunities, and it opened things up much more, and everyone was more than happy to be involved and explore things. You know, it was so heavily planned for so long. I was supposed to write it back in January, and then I didn't write it till May, and I thought, oh my God, I'm so late. I'm running so late. And then there's so many people who I work with and collaborate with on TT Productions and Dwem/WhatForthWall, who were like, oh no, it's September and we haven't even started writing. And I realized how early I was, but my God, we would never have been able to get this done with everyone who's got involved, because we had like 30 to 40 cast members per episode.
It was the most ambitious thing especially for you in Overton Audios. It was the most ambitious audio drama I think you
considering
ever...
considering I'm only editing audio. Do you remember how my computer kept crashing?
Yes,
when trying to edit it. Right. It was a nightmare, honestly.
It's just... Wait till you see we got them cooked up for the 70th.
Yeah. So I will quickly read the comments for Divergence episode 12.
No worries.
Which was the finale of Divergence series 1.
Ooh, series 1.
Anyway, Michael Cox commented saying, I'm not sure why the elusive doctor is so named. Maybe that will become to light in due course, but I really like Christina's characterization of the doctor. It contrasts so well with the supreme leader, in which Connor gives us an amazingly disconcerting performance as a dark version of the doctor. It was a pleasing resolution to the story arc and seems to be set up for something else, which I have no doubt will be equally a high quality production. Thank you again, Michael. From Yuan the Blue says, I did not expect that ending at all, but it seems to have worked out well, considering how bad it could have been. It's quite the miracle. But I said it once and I will say it again, that intro music is so, so good. The last comment from MMS, who says, well, well, a clever conclusion to this conclusive closure of the series. I rather enjoyed it. Every doctor had their part, and the elusive doctor really had their time to shine in this one. I cannot wait for their adventures when they start. But I guess for now, it's all over. Or perhaps with the multiverse, it's far from being all over. I like the pun. Good Hartnell. But so yeah, with Divergence, we're going to be expanding that. We are doing a second series. Yes. I've talked about it a little bit on other things, but we are going to be doing a second series. It's not going to be happening immediately because this was a monthly series. I'm not in any way prepared for series 2 for next year, not at all. So it will be another year or so. I'm aiming for 2025 monthly. That's what I'm aiming for, but we'll see.
It's just because this took you a year prep.
Well, yeah, I started making this in June 2022. Like, I had to start 6 months in advance, whereas now I'm letting the dust settle because I'm relaxing a bit, trying to get casually back into things again, and then we'll look at it again. But I have left an after credits scene in there, which explains what happened to all the warden and what's happened to any variants and stuff like that. And of course, this was the first proper story that you really get to see the Doctor after Cravat, and there are such references. And I'm really looking forward to seeing how people react to her when her adventures start, which aren't as far away as you think. That's all that I have to say on it. Now, Daniel.
You go, Chatters.
Indeed. Oh, no. Oh. but Daniel, First Doctor Adventures, Wanderers in the Fourth Dimension, Episode 1.
There's so many comments to these ones.
There
so...
are a lot of comments on this one, so let me know if you need me to jump in and help. Like, right. There are a lot of paragraphs in this.
I feel I should save Michael's comments to last, because for one, he wrote and he starred in these volumes, so I'm going to keep those to the last. Of
very well, episode. Very well.
So I'm going to start with Tom's Aiden James. He said, I loved this very personal chapter of the Doctor's life. The days just before the flight of a lifetime started, Michael has definitely done a great job of making you feel not only the sense of adventure that the Doctor wants to have, but also the dangers he faces, even from being at home. I really, really loved the last 15 minutes. So everything was pitch perfect from everyone involved, including, as mentioned before, Michael, and including the quote unquote new Doctor from an adventure in space and time near the end, which really made me believe that their journey across the stars.
Oh, that's nice.
We have you in the blue. That was a lovely listen. Hearing the original intro well at the last minute or two. Made all the more special as they left for their maiden voyage, so to speak. It was interesting to hear a bit of his personal life was before his exit from a normal Gallifreyan existence. In certain food for thoughts, to be fair, I have yet to dive into any Big Finish yet recordings. A+ job all around. Thanks, Ewan. Then we have
Kendrick.
Neil Kendrick, I found since 83, I found this very enjoyable. And Michael replied to that, I'm delighted, many thanks.
Aww.
And then thinking through 83, 68, really like this, really like it, like this.
Thank you. That's good, yes.
We have Daz Anderson, 45, really good, good storytelling. Bets then some new TV
series. It's a spelling error. He means better, but he's written bet instead. Bet than some new TV Who. But he's saying that this is better than Doctor Who currently, which
They've also said that they love the first Doctor, which you can...
Oh, that's good, that's good. Was it this episode where that infamous comment thread was? And where is it?
I have no idea. Where was it?
Do you remember that comment thread where somebody went, oh, I'm glad that, you know, I hate the Timeless Child. And what was it? Even you commented on it going, go away. And all this sort of stuff.
Yeah, we have Fred going on. I'm not sure. I might have been on the trailer.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll have a look. Do you want to read? Would you like me to read episode 2?
I gotta read Michael's comment.
Oh my goodness!
To all those listeners who have preserved the 1 hour and 8 minutes and 33 seconds, well done and many thanks. When I was writing it, I hadn't realized how much it would be to Connor and the team who took the script and breathed life into it. Sincere and heartfelt thanks. It's always a great pleasure to work with you all. However, I would like to pay particular thanks to Isaac Blake for playing
Lorcanthus,
who in a way was the inspiration behind the Doctor's decision. It was important to get that delivery right, which he certainly did. I liked the landscape. I liked the soundscape, and I must admit, when I heard the new Doctor from Adventure in Space and Time playing as the Doctor season took possession of the ship, I felt quite moved. I can't wait for the next wait to hear the next episode. Well done, Michael. Well done.
Aww. Right, shall I start reading episode 2 comments?
Yes, sir.
Which, by the way, I had a look on the trailer just now. The thread's not there.
Now that is.
I wonder if it got flagged. Because I don't know where that thread went, because I don't get email notifications about comment threads.
Yeah, I've tried to go into my comment section. I tried using the link. It probably got flagged.
Yeah, I'll have a look in a minute. All right, so we'll read the comments for episode 2. Once again, I'll leave Michael Cox's comment till last. MMS says, another hit yet again. I love this one, and I'm very impartial to the First Doctor's historical adventures. So to see us have one here was excellent. So was hearing the Doctor and Susan be stuck inside the court of Henry VIII, a royal I once played for a Doctor Who audio story years ago, in fact. But that was fantastic. And I felt actual real danger from them almost being discovered, thinking many possibilities on how they would get out of this adventure before the solution of being discovered was right in front of them, which made me very happy indeed. I think this could join a sensational list of historicals that we have for this Doctor, and it would, and it could be. Oh my God, I'm really struggling. And it could be a one I could listen to many other points in the future. 10 out of 10. Of which Michael commented back saying, that's very kind, Thomas, many thanks. Ever since I watched Sense Rites on DVD in 2012, when the Doctor mentioned meeting Henry VIII, I've wondered what actually happened. So thanks to Overton Audios that we can now take those vague musings and experience a complete adventure. See, Michael's all over it with continuity.
Yes.
And then someone called Stephen Parkin commented saying, very good. This is the second First Doctor story set in the court of Henry VIII that has just actually come out. Enjoyed both. To think that he would later marry Henry's daughter is odd. Which, then user, and then it's got a weird code afterwards, says love it. Neil Kendrick says marvelous. And then this was an interesting one. Someone with the name Sloppy Chasma says, hey, where should someone as new as me begin with audio stories from Overton Audios? This is as extended as Big Finish. I was meant to respond to that, and I never did, which I feel quite bad for. So I will respond to that after the podcast. I'll leave that tab open. But I say just start with any Doctor, really. But anyway, if you want to start with the lore and build up to it, then no you can. Worries. In fact, Dan, could you read this comment and then go on to episode 3, please?
Sure thing. Which one is that again?
Michael Cox's comment on episode 2, please.
No worries. All right, so Michael has said, well done. Well, Sir Connor, I'm fair glad you assembled this godly cast of to recreate Tudor England. You have done a fine work in bringing this adventure from parchment to the ears of the noble company of listeners. Sorry, couldn't resist. But seriously and sincerely, another great success. Apologies that I've written yet another long one. Editing must have taken days. Michael, I can't speak for Connor at the moment. I think he's popped up just to get someone. But yes, I know that Connor takes great pride in editing these audios, and he always does so with he always takes the time I feel is necessary, because yes, again, he takes great pride in it. So, and I know very much, being a First Doctor fan, he is always delighted with First Doctor content, especially from you, good sir. So thanks very much. Yeah, I'm doing the next one anyway, so I'll just jump into that as well as Connor's height. So, all right. So we got Thomas A. and James saying, this volume of adventures really brought around some great stuff. Like the other two, it was very enjoyable with the Doctor and Susan on a whirlwind of adventure, trying to solve the riddle with the rest of the cast, including at the time Cold Red and me, making the adventure more intriguing by the second. Getting more into spoiler territory, I was in awe when I listened further into the story to find it being more of a bootstrap paradox, a story with events of the first half leading into the seconds and second half and vice versa. I never thought it could be done with the First Doctor, but Michael found a way, and I was glad to find out that from listening to finishing the product in all its glory. 10 out of 10, would listen again. Cheers. Cheers, Aiden. Cheers, man. Thank you very much. And also, in reply to that, Michael said, that's kind, Thomas. And thank you for playing Pella. I'm so sorry, Michael. My dyslexia is a crux to me sometimes. And I just, especially with Doctor Who names, it is just a... It's just an unfortunate mix. And then for Michael, for Michael himself, he said, only 45 minutes. I'm mostly slipping. You are not, Michael. You're not slipping. I suppose some people may feel that the bootstrap paradox limits the storytelling potential, as we effectively know what happens when it happens for the plot resolution. However, I think that the stakes are high as they can possibly be when reality itself is threatened. So it really is a race against time to prevent the paradox and with that comes dramatic tension. Thanks to all involved in bringing the script to the world of the internet. Thank you again, Michael. I think this is the only story in the latest volume I'm yet to listen to, just because the last couple of days we had some family over and we had I haven't had time to listen and catch up with the world of Overton Audios and the First Doctor, but I will listen to this in due course. But yeah, you know, this was a lot of fun. I think I always enjoy Michael's First Doctor content, so it's always very nice to listen to it, especially with this being the first of two audios. I think that's what Connor confirmed. If not, Connor, please censor this right now. So the fact we're getting more soon-ish, I don't know. I don't know the release schedule. Connor hides things from me, so I don't spoil it, which, considering he left me alone in the podcast, too right. But yeah, I think what I most enjoy for this one as well, I always love making First Doctor audio drama cover arts. I think my favorite one, I don't know. His Majesty's Displeasure is always a favorite of mine. I like how Mineral is. I love how the vortex looks like the dark clouds. I don't know. It's always great, especially to incorporate more of Susan into these. It's also been very pleasing because we didn't really include Susan in the previous volume. So it was, well, at least not into the cover arts. So it was very nice to include Susan in there this time around.
And then because we're recording this before Christmas Day and we won't be able to read the comments on this podcast for the Blonde Doctor Christmas special, I thought it would be good to quickly read the comments that have come up on the trailer, because the trailer actually came out today as of recording. Overton Audios presents...
Charlie. Oh, thank goodness I finally found you.
You're an idiot.
Charlie.
You really think if you show up and just invite me back, I'll come?
Wait, no, this isn't...
I have people to look after now. Josh, where are you?
All aboard.
We're not supposed to be here.
You are stowaways.
Unintentionally, I promise. My friend here, Charlie, is looking for her brother, Josh.
Once on board the Christmas Express, you cannot get off.
The Christmas Express?
Krampus's workshop, I take it?
Most likely. It's a bit...
empty.
Yes. Come on, I'll have the kids somewhere. The North Pole?
What have you been told, mate? We ain't going to the North Pole.
Then where are we going?
Oh, come on, we'll talk as we walk.
I shouldn't have put you in that situation. And trust me, I have felt guilty about that every day since I left.
Doctor Who, The Blonde Doctor Adventures, The Spirit of Christmas, coming the 25th of December at 12 p.m.
Yeah.
So there's a comment from Michael Cox saying, all sounds good. And did I hear Krampus mentioned? I remember the 8th Doctor meeting him, and I'm vaguely aware that the 13th Doctor did too. Certainly an interesting creature. And then we have a comment from Instability Productions, which is George Gaidra himself, the Blonde Doctor himself, saying, it's so weird hearing this, knowing how long it's been. Bring on Christmas. Because that's the thing. With this Christmas special, it was written in June 2022.
Weird time to be writing a Christmas special, I say.
yes, it was meant for Christmas 22. It was meant for Christmas last year, but it just never really got going, sadly. We made the Transcending Time episode with the Blonde Doctor in, which came out in November of last year. Well, I say last year, it will come out last year when people are listening to this, will now be 2023. It came out in November 2022, and then a month later was supposed to be this Christmas special, but we just, the casting of Charlie Chalice and everything like that, we just never got it in time. So we moved it to the following Christmas, and then we've just not been able to make any other Blonde Doctor content since. So we're hoping that we will be able to. Sadly, George wasn't available to be able to be on the podcast to talk about the Christmas special itself. So this is my way of, you know, giving it an honourable mention.
Yeah. Because I think it coming out now, it means we get a nice sort of duology of, we got Blonde Doctor audio plus Alacrity Doctor audio the following week. So I think it's nice that we can end the year and start the year off with two doctors that that have only had sparingly amount of audio so far.
Exactly. Obviously, for Alacrity, it's his first solo story. For Blonde has appeared in other media, such as like Crimson Hunter, Transcending Time, and the Prism 60th. However, this is his first solo story as well. So they both have their first solo stories here, and we're hopeful for more. But yes,
fingers crossed, folks.
Yes, indeed. So, speaking of which, shall we? Speaking of things taking a while to get made, this month, in fact, next week, or the week after this podcast comes out, even a re-release of the short trips that originally went out on DW2012 during lockdown year is coming out. This is of the Cravat story called King of Rock, where he and Julia Breslin meet Elvis Presley. Now, we talked about this on the podcast when it originally came out on the other YouTube channel.
Shall we have someone listen to that then?
Yes. Shall we do that?
Yes, indeed. Feels like we recorded that just yesterday.
We're going to hear our voices immediately get less deeper and grungier.
Yeah. we will see.
Yes, we shall.
Elvis turns to the Doctor, asking him why he's here. Oh, we've had quite the adventure, El. We needed a break, and I brought my friend to see you, exclaims the Doctor. Elvis chuckled, adding that it's been barely a week since they saw each other. There was an Irish guy. The Doctor sighs, nodding. That was an odd night. There was a knock at the door. Elvis turns and calls whoever was knocking to enter. Elvis's agent entered the room, saying that Eddie was waiting for him.
Who's Eddie?
Asked Julia. Elvis shrugs it off, saying it's a fan regular. He'll be back in a minute, and they can properly catch up. Elvis leaves. Elvis's agent looked at the duo, asking who they are. We're just some friends passing by, says the Doctor. Elvis's agent frowns and leaves. Julia turns to the Doctor.
So?
Chuckles Julia.
Elvis. He's a bit...
Oh, don't say it, Julia. You'll only feed his ego.
So, for wave two of the DW2012 Short Tales, myself and Connor were brought along to write and narrate our own stories. And incidentally, we both wrote stories based around two music icons, two musical icons, which is the Beatles and Elvis Presley.
Not planned.
So, not planned, which is funny enough because we were sort of bundled together in that sort of sense, but saying that wasn't planned at all. So, Connor, tell us about your story. Tell us about, like, the thought process and how you came up with it.
King of Rock is essentially like my version of Rosa, in a way. Obviously, it's still set in the 50s. It's set in America in the 50s. But obviously, it's about Elvis Presley and a man who wanted to be the King of Rock, but it was never... was always living in, like, Elvis's shadow. Bear in mind, he's from the... I think it was the 28th century. I've forgotten now because I wrote it a little while ago. But he's always been compared to Elvis because he looks like him and uses similar styles, and he's not called original, but he's really good at doing what he does. So he decides to go back in time and become Elvis, kill Elvis and take his place and get the glory he always deserved. That idea actually stemmed from some little photoshops that you'd done, Dan. You did some photoshops of doctors from within the DW 2012 universe meeting famous celebrities from throughout time. So one of them was a photoshop of myself and Chelsea as Julia Breslin stood with Elvis. And that particular photo you used, it was a photo of Elvis smiling with two people stood looking at him. I was looking through them across their shoulders to Elvis. You can probably find it if you Google it. And I thought, and you photoshopped me and Julia stood next to him, but I was giving a very stern look. And I thought, oh, what if, because Elvis was always quite a laid back sort of person, what if someone's threatening Elvis and he's just laughing at them, and whilst me and Julie were taking this very seriously, what if someone's trying to kill Elvis? And it was just for fun, wasn't it? Because you'd done one of yourself, and we were just thinking, oh, that'd be a fun, that's a good backstory that we'll reference if we need to. And it's happened.
Yeah, definitely. And as for the photo itself, I'm not sure when that actual Photoshop edit will come out. It's part of another project. It may materialize at some point, but for now, it's sort of the context of the photo has now been explained in short tales, which is a lot of fun. And it was quite funny because I said, what celebrity would you like to meet? He said, Elvis. So I photoshopped you and Chelsea with Elvis. And we were just like thinking, what's the story here?
Yeah, because you had a Photoshop done with the Beatles, didn't you?
Yeah, and I had two done. One of them was with the Beatles, and it's nothing like, I might have to redo it now because it's nothing like how the story actually goes, because it's just me in a bar with the Beatles. It's not on Abbey Road, or it doesn't have Zygons or even Maggie in the photo, so I have to redo it and with more references to the story. But for my story, I just, because Maggie's character, I base her a lot off the real life actress Anya, who's a massive fan of the Beatles, so I thought it'd be fun to. So I want to do a story where Maggie is like a super fan of the Beatles, and she's trying to contain her excitement to meet them, and saying, "Oh, we're going to go to Abbey Road," but it turns out to be Abbey Road Pub in Liverpool, which is an actual place. Because I thought it was just like it'd be a funny gag.
Plus, it's very doctory to do. Like, you get the right name, but it's just the wrong place. Like, you know, like Tooth and Claw, where they go to 1979, but he misses it by 100 years and goes, oh, it's 1879. Oh, same difference. You know, I like those. I like that little bit. I don't think my doctor's ever done that yet.
Well, there's still time yet, mate.
Yeah.
But, and then I was like, okay, but who would be a good idea? Who would the villains be? And I thought, I really like the Irish doctor to face the Zygons. So I thought, the Zygons? The idea originally was like the Zygons were like the threats and the Beatles would help, I thought. But then Dom actually recommended, well, the Zygons are the Beatles in disguise. Mm. And I thought, that's brilliant. That's brilliant. And the brilliance of Dominic Greenwood Martin there.
Oh, lovely.
But so that was how that story came to be. And it was a lot of fun. And it was the first time I really put my English accent back into audio form for
narrating, you'd put on an English accent, didn't you?
Yeah, and I apologize immediately to any English folk out there who are traumatized by me putting on an English accent. I can guarantee you it won't happen again.
Are we forgetting the English doctor? Because as of recording, he appeared in the wrong cravat.
Well, again, it won't happen again. So going forward from this podcast, it won't happen again.
Oh, right then.
And plus, that was archived audio from a previous. So that
was archived audio
again
from 2016, from before I was even a part of it, of this all.
Yeah.
So it was that parallel doctor, wasn't it? Where the next incarnation after me was an English you.
Indeed, yeah.
It's
weird to think that's 4 years ago now since I recorded that audio.
Yeah, and it just came out last week. If you think I plan far in advance, then you haven't seen anything, yeah?
Oh, God, yeah.
Half a decade in the making.
Indeed. Yeah,
I found it interesting doing some audiobooks, though, because I've had some people sometimes say that I should try it, and I could never really properly get into it. It was always just, I don't know, I thought I'd give it a go with this, and I'm glad I did. And it certainly opened my eyes to an easier way of audio making. But I think part of me will never truly leave, like, forecast audio dramas. But
yeah,
I'm giving it a go, and like with some of the Cravat Doctor stuff, and I'm just giving him a break, especially after season 4. Indeed. I need it, and he needs it.
But still, I think it was still good to. It was testing the waters when it came to the audiobooks, and now you're going ahead with them, so I think it was a successful test.
Oh yeah, it takes much longer. It takes much longer than the script, though. I'm better at scripting than I am actually the whole like write. Like, oh, that sounds stupid when I say, but the whole writing thing. But like for me, it's a case of I've got so used to writing stories in script form. It just doesn't work for me anymore, you know?
I get what you mean, mate.
So it took me about a month. It took me about a month to write that audiobook, and I'd written one half of it. It had taken me about 2 weeks, and last night I was just sat there going, I need to finish this, because otherwise I've not written anything over this weekend. I always try to write or edit at least one thing per weekend to try and keep on top of it when I'm so busy.
Yeah, absolutely.
But yeah, all in all, I think I'll warm into audiobooks. I've been listening to some more big finishes, you know, Doctor Who short trips. Just trying to get into them, and I've listened to 4 series out of the 10 so far, but I'm keeping up with the releases that are happening right now. So technically, I've only got up to series 9, and I'm on series 5 at the moment. So that's all right. But I think. I think it would be good in certain things. I've got some ideas for some time traveler audiobooks, which I'll see if they work out. But like I said, I'll always sort of have a soft place in my heart for forecast audio dramas.
And welcome back to the podcast. I suspect our voices have either become clearer with our microphones or deeper and more tired. Because when we started the podcast... We had energy then.
We had time.
Then. Yeah, we did.
Yeah. But, I've seen microphones I did back then, so it's a good chance here. Has the quality of this microphone, has it gone off over time?
Fingers crossed. Yes. I'm gonna have a quick look in the background whilst talking as to which episode it was and what month it was. Because I believe yes, it was September 2020. So at that point, we'd been working together for 2 months.
Oh God, yeah.
Yes, that's exactly. Yeah, it's like, oh bloody hell! Like what? Like, you're gonna have a realization there, you know.
But
I was thinking about doing this thing because the schedule's being more relaxed. And by this point. By the time this podcast comes out, we won't have actually announced really kind of what's coming up in February.
Yeah.
Because, tell a lie, we're not talking about February, realization, because we've been talking about how to kind of change up the podcast. So with the podcast, we usually talk about the stuff that's coming up this month rather than the stuff that came before, but we're swapping things around now, which is why the last podcast was a little bit more relaxed, and we only really talked about First Doctor, and then we talked about Marinus, that being Marinus Paradox on Fractured Timeline. So as a result, in this podcast, we haven't actually talked about anything that's coming out in January properly. So as a result, because we're not going to do so much a segment on this, for this particular podcast, a trailer for something that's coming up, we're going to do. This is really well rehearsed.
Yeah.
basically, we're going to do a segment at the end of the podcast now where we share a trailer for something that's coming out in this month that this podcast is coming out. So, like, for example, the next podcast will show what's coming out in February. That is if there's multiple releases, and this month there is, because we've got a mixture of things like the Dripping Hartnell podcast coming up, coming back twice a week, because we're catching it with a backlog that we've recorded since July, but there's not really a trailer that follows that. What the other thing is that we've got the short trips that we've talked about, but then we've got the fourth episode of Transcending Time coming out, and we mentioned that earlier when referring to George and the Blonde Doctor, which there hasn't been a Transcending Time since November 2022.
So it's long overdue for a new Transcending Time episode.
Yes, it's very.
It's been a busy year. The 60th anniversary was a thing.
Yeah, exactly. Like last year, I basically shifted things around, and I'm going to be doing different things. But essentially, here is the trailer for the next Transcending Time episode. Off we go. Overton Audios presents.
I know her. She's my friend.
Doctor.
Nice to see you again, Ace.
We are gathered tonight on a wonderful occasion, the birth date of our Emperor Howard Lovecraft.
Professor, is that really...
Not the time now, Ace. We have company, but I will explain later, trust me.
The man who locked me up all those years ago. It would feel wrong not having you witness my ascension.
A being from the old universe, brought over by Rassilon himself, his own pet.
But he rests in the middle of the cosmos, for if he ever woke...
Chaos would ensue. You can't defy the laws of gods.
You are not a god. You are just a pawn in a larger game.
All together now. We must be ready for the ascension. All hail the glorious house of Lovecraft.
Doctor Who. Transcending Time. The Sleeping God. Coming the 27th of January, 2024 at 12 p.m. And wow. That was the trailer. My goodness me.
Thank
my
God.
Goodness. Yes, it was the Northern Doctor and the Seventh Doctor. That was recorded 2 years ago. It was recorded alongside the Blonde Doctor and Eighth Doctor one.
Yeah, I remember we were talking about this, like we initially were like doing the Blonde Doctor one. We were thinking about doing like another one with the Northern Doctor, meets the Seventh.
Oh yeah. Yes, 100%. Indeed.
Always interesting doing these things.
Indeed. And hopefully we're able to get a sort of segment together to talk about it next month. We'll find out. But that's another thing for after Christmas, Daniel. For now, we must flee. We have Christmas and New Year to have ourselves. From everyone else's perspectives, it's already done. Why am I making it sound like we're in a Roald Dahl book? The way I'm saying it, it's like in a weird rhythm. Going, and now we flee to eat a pea and go and have Christmas and New Year, and hopefully for Christmas get some new camera gear. I've got a bit
Are you
mad.
Feeling okay, Chatters?
I think I've got a bit mad. I'm losing it.
It's fine.
The end of the year and reflections do that.
Yes, indeed. Well, here's to next month, because next month, even though it'll be February, by next month we'll have the following. We would have another Transcending time. And do you know what else we were able to talk about?
What?
Shuji Gatwa's first proper episode as a Doctor.
Very, very true. Very, very true indeed. Sweet, sweet Daniel.
Anyway, shall we wrap things up for Christmas, sir?
Yes. Well, I mean, technically we already did in the last one, but this is us wrapping things up for January for the beginning of a new series of podcasts. I believe this is the fifth one now.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it is. It's the fifth series of the podcast. We're very close to reaching podcast number 50.
Oh, yeah.
50 months.
Yeah, we're going to have to do something for that. We'll figure out closer to the time. Anyway, thanks everyone for listening to this podcast.
Indeed.
Hope you all had a lovely New Year's, and me and Chatters here will see you next month.
Indeed. See you later. Farewell.
Bye.